Hey.
Come
Trusted him alone to save you. And it doesn't matter how you dress, how you look, where you go to church, what kind of music you listen to. All those things are important, but they don't matter if you don't have Jesus inside of you. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man will get to God except through Jesus Christ. Almost finished here, but I want you to let that sink in. In a room of 500 people, there's probably a few that have never accepted Christ as their Savior. And for me, it was a time when I was younger. For Bryn, it was the same way. It was when she was younger. For some people, it's when they're 5 or 6. Some people, it's when they're 50 or 60. But folks, we're not guaranteed that we're going to live to be 50 or 60. God could come back, or we could die in a car accident tomorrow. We don't know. It's not, your eternal destiny is not something to mess around with. If you don't know for sure that heaven is your home, and that were you to die when you walk out of here, you would spend eternity with God, please get that settled, either in your heart. Right now, it's very simple. You don't have to technically even come down to an altar, although sometimes we do that, and that's good. You don't have to pray a long, fancy prayer. It's simply telling God that you're turning away from your sins and you're trusting Him alone to take you to heaven. Listen, trusting in somebody else is not going to get you there. I had great parents, and Bryn had great parents, and we had a great pastor. But our parents and our pastors would do nothing for our eternal destiny. None of that is going to take you to heaven. It's not trusting in good works. It's not trusting in baptism. It's not trusting in church membership. It's not confessing your sins to somebody else. The Bible says that we have one mediator. We've got one way to get to God, and that is the man Christ Jesus. And if you've never trusted Him as your Savior and turned from your sins, I encourage you to do that today. We're just going to bow our heads in prayer, and then we're going to start the service. Dear Lord, I pray that if there's anybody here who does not even know You as their Savior, Lord, I pray that today, even now, they would just ask You into their hearts. They would turn away from their wicked ways. Lord, we realize that even a little lie, one lie makes us a liar. One small thing that we steal makes us a thief. One look of lust makes us an adulterer. Hatred makes us a murderer. God, we realize we've broken one point, we've broken it all. We're guilty of the whole law. And Lord, You don't send anybody to hell. Our sins send us there. Your loving God, You created heaven for us, and I pray that everybody in this room would understand that. I believe that almost everybody here is a Christian already, but if there's anybody that's not, I pray that they would trust You today as their Savior. Maybe they need to talk to somebody afterwards. I pray they would do that, Lord, and get it settled. I pray that this service, Lord, and the marriage to follow would honor and glorify You, that we remember it's not about me or about Bryn or about anybody else. It's about bringing You honor and glory. I pray that Your name would be lifted up today, and that at the end of my life, a good side, we could look back and realize that through everything, You've been good, Lord. I pray that everybody in here, we would remember, go forward, to be that salt and light, and to be a testimony to others. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
prohibit this woman to be married to this man? You may be seated. Thank you for coming. This is a very special day, and so that he would not forget and say the wrong name, wrote Jeff and Beth. And on that day, they became one. And this is what they saw. I'd like to welcome the father of the bride to come and say a few words and lead us in our opening word of prayer.
Thank you so much for being here. Bear with me if I'm a little emotional. I tend to be anyway. This is a somewhat important event. It's a big thing to me to stand here and see people that came to witness my only daughter. Bontrager's cheating. They've got more daughters. This is my only daughter, my whole family, and one or another is, you know, on the platform, you know, whatever. But it's not about me, and it's not about my wife, and it's not even about my daughter, Mitchell. This is something from June 13th, 1987, which I mentioned that, when my wife and I were married, and we set out to raise a family. But God saw fit to bless us. Tried to do right. Tried to live for God. And despite all of our imperfections, God saw fit to give us a family. God saw fit to bless our family. And although we think Bryn's perfect, eventually we'll find out that she's not. Most of the time she is. God is blessed us. This is what God did. This is not what Jeff and Beth did. This is not what Marlon and Beth Bontrager did. This is what God did. And I want to thank the public for blessing us. And I want to encourage Mitchell and Bryn. I want to encourage all of you also, but especially Mitchell and Bryn, as this is their special day. My wife and I just celebrated in June our 30th anniversary. I'm hoping that we can do the same as when I could stand in the same place, look each other in the eye, and say, 3 years ago, we did this. And they all have a daughter or a son standing there. Girl stand up here and said 3 years ago. I scribbled their name. I don't know if he scribbled their name or not, but I know he has part-time names. I'm hoping that God blesses them like he's blessed us. It's been wonderful. Not always perfect. We've had problems and we've had troubles. I suppose nobody else in here had any troubles. I'm just thankful that God's offered to bless us in spite of us. And I'm thankful for the family he gave us. And I just pray that Mitchell and Bryn would give themselves to each other and serve the Lord with their whole heart. Let's pray for this part of this day. Lord, thank you for the people that came. I pray that you'd be here today. Thank you, Lord, just for giving me the strength to say what I just said. Thank you, Mitchell and Bryn, for their lives and their testimonies. Lord, we have a number of people here. It's just an example of testimony of what they are and what they've been. Lord, I pray that you bless them in their life to continue on, to live for you, to love you, and to serve you. Thank you for all that you have for us. Bless this service, please, and be here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much, Jeff. I appreciate that. I'm going to have you guys stay back here just a little bit. I had an opportunity to preach to them for about 2 hours. So, this is what they saw. As I think about Moses' parents seeing that their son was the goodly child, and we understand that that's why God chose Moses. It's because of that legacy. They saw that he was a goodly child, and they were not willing to just go with the flow and go with the culture and go with what everybody else was doing. They had a vision for their child. Bryn, when everybody else saw the messy bibs and the sleepless nights and the loads of diapers and the bills and the trials and struggles that come, many times with having little children, they looked beyond that and they saw this day. They saw their children walking in truth. All of their family here today celebrating together. This is what they saw. They looked beyond what everybody else was looking at, and they saw something more. Mitchell, when they saw cute little Mitchell with his little grin and all of the messes that he would make around the house, Todd moving around, they looked beyond and they saw something more. They had a vision. And this is why they prayed. It wasn't because somebody said that's what they ought to do. It wasn't because they wanted to be looked upon as somebody to be applauded. It was because of this, the product, if I could call it that. They saw that the extra investment of family devotions and time spent together, when, and you soon will find out, it's something that does not come naturally. It has to be carved out. But that one day it would be worth it. And by faith, they saw this. I'd just like to start out by saying, if you will look beyond even today, with all of this beauty and all of the memories, that you'll look back to this day for the rest of your life. But if you'll always look beyond by faith, enjoying today, enjoying tomorrow, enjoying every stage of life, and if you will look beyond to the children that God may bless you with someday, to the legacy of being grandparents, to the legacy of being able to stand and see your children marry another godly young lady or godly young man, it will give you the strength to do what is necessary. Not only did Beth and Jeff see what we're seeing today, not only did Marlon and Becky see this, God saw this. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 19 and verse 4, this is Jesus, the Son of God, while on earth, speaking about God the Father. He said, he which made them at the beginning, made them male and female, and said, for this cause, male and female, for this cause, shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife. That's a wonderful thing, isn't it? And they twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. The Bible says that God said, whoso findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor of the Lord. So we have to understand that they have to understand, we have to understand, I have to understand that this is a God thing. God defined, God invented, God created marriage. And that is the foundation that we stand on. God saw this today. And he said, I have built foundations for your marriage. If you will build your marriage upon that foundation, your life will have good success, the Bible says. Your life will be prosperous. You will have joy and happiness. And I'm talking about true joy and happiness, not something fleeting that the world chases after. I want to give you just briefly a few of those foundations. Foundation number one, and this is for all of us. Foundation number one is the Word of God. We hear a lot about the definition of marriage as we stand here today to celebrate marriage. Christians from all flavors, if you want to call it that, talk about the definition of marriage. But without the Word of God, we have no definition of marriage. Everyone says God defined marriage, and he did, but how do we know that? The Word of God. So if you will take above all else the Word of God and place it in your marriage for love, for relational issues, for discipline for your children, for love and grace and mercy, for others, for the gospel. If you will take the Word of God and you will build your marriage upon it, the Bible promises that you will have good success. The book of the law shall not depart out of my mouth. Thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. We have no marriage here today without the Word of God. And so that is the first foundation. And in a day and age where the culture is running from the Word of God, I'm talking about Christianity. We talk a lot about Jesus, but we don't follow the biblical pattern to exalt the Word above Jesus. You ought to worship the Word before you worship Jesus. That's how God put it. I have exalted my word above all my name. And so if Brennan Mitchell and you and I take the word of God and let it be the only and the final authority in all matters of faith and practice and marriage and child and relationships and everything you do, if you'll base it upon the word of God, you will already have a foundation built by God, the word of God, to see your marriage grow and to see a mighty impact in your life. Let me just say this, in this day and age of culture saying, tearing apart the word of God, they'll say you cannot have the word of God, it can't be perfect, but God promised that it could be. Just as one day they will stand before God without error, holy, blameless. Do you believe that? If you know Jesus as your personal Savior, as Mitchell so put? And we believe that God can preserve them holy, blameless, and without error. And he said, if I can do that to somebody like Mitchell or Bryn or Joe or you, how much more can I do that with my word to every generation? And so let me just say, Mitchell and Bryn, know that, and I know that you know this, but I challenge you on your marriage day, know that you can have a Bible that you can hold in your hand that is without error because God promised it. And stand upon that word and let it define your marriage. Don't let a pastor define your marriage. Don't let friends and people define your marriage. Let the word of God, every choice you make, in childbirth, in what church you attend, and who you allow to influence your children, may it be upon some the word of God without error and holds it high. You say, is that really important? I've got a question. How can marriage be defined or lived out without the manual from the Creator? And so as you stand before God one day, holy, blameless, without error, understand that he has given us his word without error. I have exalted my word above all my name. The second foundation to build upon that God has already given you. You didn't do this. You didn't create the word of God and give it to us miraculously, and I don't understand how he did it, nor do I understand how he can preserve me to the day that I died as holy and blameless, but he did it. The second thing that he did was give you a legacy. A legacy. The Bible says, honor thy father and thy mother. It does not end today. It didn't say until you cleave to your wife. No, now you begin to respect and obey him. You begin to reverence one another and love one another and submit to one another. But you still honor your father and your mother. Do you know how you honor someone? The greatest form of honoring someone is learning from their life. Positive and negative. My dad has said to me many times, son, I hope that you learn the things that I did that were wrong. I hope that you learn to not do them. That's honoring him. Learning from mistakes. But with your parents, you don't see very many mistakes. So learn from the good and follow in their footsteps. Paul said to Timothy, he said, stir up the faith that is in thee. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. There's a lot of stories that I wanted to tell, some laughter and jokes, but I won't do that. In a little bit, you're going to go up to the party, and you can share in those, but I will say this. Your mom and dad, I haven't seen the imperfections, but they both have said and would say that they haven't been perfect. So learn from that. But far outweighing the imperfections are the perfections. Watch and look at their faithfulness down through the years. We live in a time where people are blown about by every wind of doctrine, blown about by every philosophy and things that are coming and going. They stood here upon the word of God, that's why you stand here. They have stood upon the word of God, and that's why you stand here, and they stand here. The last, but not least, is the foundation of biblical love. Your marriage is built upon true love, not what comes from culture and society. Love is a choice. It is something that you have chosen before today. You say, well, what about this feeling? I'm wanting you to shut up so I can kiss my bride. Okay. That is something that God gives to you as a gift and gives to you as a gift. And it's a wonderful thing, and it's honorable. The Bible teaches that, and it's a beautiful thing. But that's not love. That is a gift and a byproduct of love, but that's not love. But the world will tell you that's what love is. It's not. Love is a choice. The Bible says, though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. That's a choice, not a feeling. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. That is not a feeling. The feelings will be wonderful if you first stand upon the faith of God's word that love is a choice. Feelings come and feelings go, and feelings are deceiving. My warrant is the word of God, not else is worth believing. As Christ gave himself for the church, and I imagine many times he looks down at churches and says, wow, they're not really following me the way that I outlined, but he loves us anyways. And he's not willing that any should care, that all should come to repentance. You look at your wife, and you love her in the same way. When she has her bad days, does she have bad days? If she has bad days, and if he has bad days, you love him and you love her, even as Christ loved the church. I have a box. Would you mind, sir, on the front row, just holding up that box for me, please? A lot of people think marriage as a gift. We have a lot of gifts that have been given, and you think, this is wonderful, I'm being given a gift today. And in that gift box is security, Bryn. It's partnership and friendship, my best friend. I give you my whole heart, and we have this camaraderie, we have this fellowship, and we have all of these things, and people get married, and then they get into their first 6 months or a year of marriage, and they look in the box, and they realize many times that it's empty. And they say things like this, well, I just don't love him anymore. I just don't feel like it's working anymore. Because a lot of people do not realize that marriage is an opportunity. It is a box, go ahead and turn the box upside down if you will. It is a box that is empty. It's a beautiful thing. But God gives you, thank you, sir, God gives you the institution of marriage so that you now can build marriage. Whatever you put in that marriage box is what you will be able to reap from. If you put kind words, the word of God, love, acceptance, security, unconditional forgiveness, respect, the list can go on and on and on, you will be able to withdraw from that marriage banking account. I'm going to ask Marlon Bontrager to come at this time, the father of the groom. He's going to share a word with us at this time. Thank you for your example to us and to my generation of faithfulness for the Marlon.
Mitchell Brent had a lot of chance to think in the last 24 hours with three marriages in less than 24 hours. A lot of things in my mind, but I can really share with you today to be a blessing and encouragement. I had to think back in 1993, one day when I came in from the farm, and my wife had just got done listening to a program on Focus on the Family. And Judge Heckman, Judge from Michigan, had spoken on the importance of the blessing of children. Psalm 127:3 says, children are a heritage of the Lord, but through the woman says the Lord. And I thought about that, and I know I've had this conversation with you, Mitchell, I know how you've been feel about this. But you know, my wife and I were going to have this little beautiful American family. And after we heard that message, we said, Lord, we'll take whatever you give us. I thought about that a lot, folks, because there would not have been a double wedding yesterday if we would have not listened to that message. It would have been a curse. It would have been a Joshua, Caleb, Elizabeth, Isaac, Rebecca, and then. And so I say all that because you can say, well, you want to allow the Lord to bless us with many children. That's a great thing. But I want to tell you, God may bless you with one child, maybe zero, maybe 15. I have no idea. But there's some, you said it'd be great? That would be great, right? Give the diapers a run for it. That'd be great. But you know, as Judge Heckman said that day, in American Christianity, we are much more anti-abortion than we are pro-life. But there's something much greater than allowing the blessing of children. You may say, well, we want to raise a godly family. We want to have family devotions. We want to speak into their lives to be the Bible. Raise a godly family is going to make an impact. And who wouldn't say they want that? I want that. You all want that. But there's something greater than having a godly family. And I'll give you that in a minute. Zig Ziglar actually said, many people spend more time planning their wedding than they do their marriage. And I thought about that. A lot of hours went into this wedding. A lot of hours went into the wedding yesterday. And other weddings. How much time do we really take in planning our marriage? I think many times we have a pea-sized vision in life. And I was really convicted of that. You know, the last year or two, I've spent some time on the road. I've walked through graveyards. I walk through graveyards, and it sounds like a morbid thing to do, but I read gravestones. what people put on their gravestones. It's called the epitaph. And I would encourage you, Bryn, to sit down while you're in your honeymoon and write out what you want on your gravestones. That could be a very valuable thing to do. And I want you to encourage you to be inspired by men and women that have lived a legacy. Pastor alluded to that. Years ago, there was a marriage. You've heard this story much longer than you have, Bryn. A wedding day much like this one. The bride was up front. The groom wasn't around anywhere. Nobody could find him. And the crowd was gathered. The wedding was getting a start. And you thought you should have done that today? No. They found the groom. He was down the road about a mile, up in a haymow, kneeling beside his head, getting right with God. His name was James Taylor. He was the grandfather of Hudson Taylor. And today you can trace 9 generations of Taylors serving the Lord. Also today, if you go out to Princeton University, you go across the street to Princeton University and you meander through the graveyard at Princeton University, you will find many famous people buried there. You go to President's Row, you'll see Grover Cleveland. You'll see many others, Alexander Hamilton and others there. But all those men in President's Row had no impact to society and culture like a husband and wife that's buried there in Princeton Cemetery. I'm talking about Jonathan and Sarah Edwards, a couple that had a tremendous vision for down the road what they wanted to have with their family. To give you an example, a young scholar by the name of E.A. Winship did some research on the Edwards family. He traced 150 years of Edwards, and here's what he found. 1 Vice President of the United States, 3 U.S. Senators, 3 Governors, 3 Mayors, 13 College Presidents, 30 Judges, 65 Professors, 80 Public Office Holders, 100 lawyers, 100 missionaries around the world. That's what he found. But at the same time, he did some research on the legacy of Max Jukes. Max Jukes and his family grew up in the state of New York. A very ruthless, vile man, very wicked. He traced the lineage of Max Jukes. Many of them were alcoholics. Many of them served much time in the prison system in the state of New York. In fact, he said the Jukes family has cost the state of New York millions and millions of dollars. What's the difference between Jonathan Edwards and Max Jukes? One had a godly vision, one didn't. One of my favorite passages of scripture, Psalm 112, says, "Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, delighteth great in his commandments. His seed shall be mighty upon earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Unto the upright there riseth light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion and righteousness. A good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Surely he shall not be moved forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. His heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he see a desire upon his enemies. He has dispersed. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endureth forever. His horn shall be exalted with honor. The wicked shall see it and be grieved. He shall gnash with his teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked shall perish." Brennan Mitchell, as I look at that passage, I've always looked at the blessings of a godly man. But in the very last verse, it said, "The wicked shall see it and be grieved." The problem in America today, the wicked aren't looking at anything or grieving anymore because there's so little godliness anymore. So I would encourage you, I know you're trying to go to Halifax, have a great time. Sit down with a legal pad sometime. Sit down with a legal pad. Spend a couple hours. 12 o'clock to get to the year 2087. I did the math. You're going to be 93. You'll be 95 if the Lord tarries. Picture yourself at the Mitchell and Bryn Bontrager family reunion. Decide what you would like to see your family reunion be. Do you want to have a bunch of alcoholics there? Do you want to have a bunch of lives that are just in shambles? Or do you want to have a godly legacy? You want to have a godly legacy? We'll start today. We'll start in Halifax. We'll start next year, on and on. By God's help, it's not a formula. Like Pastor said, the answers are in the book. But don't just look at your own family, but blessing your children. That's great. Raising a godly family, that's great. Look way down the road. You look at the Fortune 500 companies in America. Why did they rise and fall? Because the CEO typically did not have a vision more than maybe 10 years down the road. Board of Chrysler, don't hang around because they just have a 5-5-year vision. They're looking down the road. The secular culture understands that. It's time we as Christians, young men, young women, families, get a grip of that and look down the road. So start planning your reunion in 2087. I probably won't be here, but I know you'll have a good time.
Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for both of these fathers and the joy, Lord, of fellowship that we've already seen before the wedding and the joy we're about ready to enjoy the fellowship afterwards together, Lord, as we greet the bride and groom, as we enjoy the food, as we see friends. And Lord, what a reunion this is. May this be a day, Lord, long remembered as a happy memory, and not one that was erased and torn apart by men. God, may you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Bryn and Mitchell, if you have freely and deliberately chosen each other as partners for life in the holiest estate of matrimony, would you please face one another and join hands? If you were here yesterday, you heard me say that what is about ready to take place cannot be understated. What binds marriage? A few minutes ago, we talked about what builds marriage. We know that love builds marriage. We know that a legacy of following those that have gone on before that did it right builds marriage. Love builds marriage. God's word builds marriage. Your local church builds marriage through the preaching and teaching of God's word and your serving of others. But these things do not bind marriage. What makes two individuals married? God binds marriage. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. So it's the covenant that binds marriage. God was looking down at the children of Israel, and they were leaving their wives, and they were going and marrying pagan wives. They were essentially putting away or divorcing their wives. And here's what God said to them. He said, because the Lord hath been witness, that's what he's doing right now, between thee and the wife of thy youth, yet is she thy companion, wife of thy covenant. Therefore take heed to your spirit, and let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth. For the Lord God of Israel saith that he hateth the putting away. Then he says, when thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it. So, what binds marriage is not because two people like one another, or because romance, or because of all the things that build a marriage. It's not about love. That does not bind marriage. What you are about ready to do in the covenant is a covenant to one another as God, with God as the witness. And by the way, for all of us, you say, well, I didn't have a church wedding. God defined marriage. I don't care where you got married. When you made those vows, it was a covenant before God, and God sealed the marriage. They didn't seal it, I didn't seal it, and you're not going to seal it. God Almighty is going to seal the marriage when you give your covenant one to another. It's a very precious thing. It's a very holy thing. And it is something that is not to be it cannot be undone for any reason whatsoever. Because it is not about physical, it's not about emotional, it's not about circumstances, it is about a covenant. And so I would challenge you right now, if you're ready to do this, and I believe that you are, that you take it with the seriousness and importance that God is listening and is your witness to seal the marriage with this covenant. Mitchell Bontrager, are you ready? Mitchell Bontrager, wilt thou have this woman to be thy wedded wife, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Wilt thou love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep thee only unto her so long as ye both shall live? Do you so promise?
Yeah.
Bryn Leppert, wilt thou have this man to be thy wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Wilt thou obey him, love, honor, and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep thee only unto him so long as ye both shall live? Do you so promise? Mitchell, at this time, I want you to give these vows to your bride. I, Mitchell, take thee, Bryn. To be my wedded wife. To have the whole. From this day forward. For better, for worse. For richer, for poor. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish. Till death do us part. According to God's holy word. I give you my promise.
I give you my promise.
And Bryn? I, Bryn, take thee, Mitchell, to be my wedded husband, to have and to hold from this day forward. For better, for worse, for richer, for poor, in sickness and in health, to love, cherish, and obey, till death do us part. According to God's holy word, I give thee my promise. Mitchell, do you have a ring for your bride? No payback. That was nice. Please place the ring on your bride's finger. Hold the ring. The ring is a symbol of unending love, God's unending love. It is a symbol of a seal. The ring has always been used as a seal. It's a symbol that God is sealing this marriage. And third, it is a symbol that you are now, when you say these vows, giving everything that you own. The clothes on your back, any money in the bank account, anything and everything that you have now belongs to her. In a moment, the same to you. This represents the earthly or worldly goods that now become one. Please repeat these vows. With this ring, I be wed.
With this ring, I be wed.
And with all my worldly goods, I be endowed.
And with all my worldly goods, I be endowed.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And of the Holy Ghost.
Bryn, you have a ring for your groom. Please hold the ring and give your vows to Mitchell. With this ring, I be wed. And with all my worldly goods, I be endowed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. You may now light the infant. Now, Bryn and Mitchell, by the power vested in me as a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I now pronounce you husband and wife. Mitchell, you may now kiss your bride. Again, thank you for coming. There'll be plenty of time up there to fellowship and to meet and greet the bride and groom. How many of you have smelled those brownies or whatever that is? How many of you can smell those? I'm getting a cross breeze up here, and I'm hungry and ready to go eat. We're going to have a word of prayer together. Father, we thank you for what we just experienced here today. Thank you for Bryn and all the planning that has gone into this wedding that she and her friends and her family has poured into. And then Mitchell and the work preparing the home and preparing the future life. God, I pray that you bless them as they go on their honeymoon. Lord, as they come back to build the life, thank you that we got to witness the binding of this covenant that we know, Lord, will last until death do them part if they follow your word. Thank you for all that you've done and for all these guests that have come from literally all over the world. And we appreciate that, God, and we thank you for bringing us together. In Jesus' name, amen. You will be dismissed by Rose.